I'm going to introduce Armanda. Armanda Simone is with Kiwetinuk Okimakinak Research Institute, or CORI. On the, we partnered together, the two tribal councils, today to put a two-part presentation together.
Ta-da!
I don't know if I should. Okay. I am Natalie Popovich, Windigo First Nations Council. With us today, we have Andrew Locke from Ministry of Natural Resources and Forestry, and his colleague, Ryan?
Ryan.
They'll also be helping us later today. So, as the description of this session, we wanted to break this out in two parts, and we really wanted this to be a little bit of hands-on working together, and we decided to provide you with an opportunity to share some of your knowledge with each other. So that's why we're kind of waiting for a couple more people, because this is a pretty small group, and we were hoping to break out into some small working groups and work through a couple of questions to give you guys an opportunity to hear from each other rather than just us. So if you think there might be other people out there who might want to join us, then let's get them in the door, because this is an opportunity for you guys to learn about harvesting practices from your colleagues rather necessarily from us. And then, of course, the Ministry of Natural Resources will present on some of the work that they've been doing for data management and harvesting resources. So without further ado, we got a couple of slides. We'll explain what we're trying to accomplish today.
So defined sustainable, so as everyone knows, able to maintain at a certain rate or level. And harvesting, gather crops as harvest, catch or kill animals for human consumption or use.
So we just want to make sure that it's clear when we're talking about sustainable harvesting, what that actually means. It might mean something different to you guys. I would love to hear that if it does. But in the English language, when we're talking about harvesting, we're talking about taking something off the land, in this case, in a sustainable manner, which means that it can replenish itself. So I think that in traditional languages or traditional practices, it's probably defined somewhat different, but in the English language, this is the words that we use. So I just want to be clear that that's what we're talking about.
Oh, here you go, okay. So why the discussion? First Nations are known as stewards of the land, managing the sustainability of the land base and environment on behalf of the populations who depend on it. Land use planning efforts, short and long-term planning of the land and its resources for protection and use.
So we thought this might be a good time to do this workshop when we gather as a region. And we're bringing in First Nations from all across Northern Ontario. In the work that I've been doing in the last 4 years, it's come across my table a couple of times that community members themselves have been concerned about sustainability and sustainable practices. So in their land use planning efforts or in their data collection, they start having that discussion amongst each other and bringing it to the planning table sometimes, that they start recognizing how there's been a shift in harvesting practices in some locations, and they're concerned but not really sure how to plan for it. So I thought by opening this up into a room like this, that we could start a dialogue on what does sustainable harvesting mean and how can it be influenced at the planning table.
So traditional knowledge versus scientific data, so to maintain the ability and traditional practices that we depend on. Having traditional practices change, has the sustainability been affected, and how can planning exercises assist in determining models, best practices for future generations? So then this will also lead into some of our questions in our breakouts that we will do with everybody. We're okay to start now, we've got enough.
So this is a key concept right here of today's session is, have our traditional practices changed? Can we identify that? And has sustainability been affected on the land? And I think when we talk about traditional knowledge versus scientific, the traditional knowledge is going to come from the land users. And I, you know, again, we have a pretty sparse room today. Hope that there would be more people. But we need to be able to collect that data in some kind of format for planning efforts. And we know that the ministry is doing their own work on that. And later today, we'll hear from them on what their program is, and specifically for Moose. We're gonna hone in on the Moose project, but they're gonna talk a little bit about their own data collection and how they're using that data to, I'll let Andy talk more about it when he presents.
Okay, so we're gonna break you guys into four groups. You guys can pick whichever, so there'll just be group one, you can go here, group two, group three, and group four.
So we want to sit together at one table, and we're going to bring some paper, and you're each just going to have one question to focus on, and the idea is to have a discussion on that one question. So at table number one, we're going to ask ourselves this question on traditional harvesting practices. Describe the traditional teachings on harvesting. Have there been any traditional teachings that we are aware of? And we would like to just document them, make a list to find out if we've learned something new from each other. Do we know of them? And then we're going to have a chance to just talk about that so that everybody in the room gets a chance to hear what we were able to discuss on each of those four points. So number two, on modern day practices, what's changed in the last few generations from the traditional spring and fall hunt practices? So have we seen a change? I think we have, based on the information I get in my communities. Modern day elder to youth teaching. So what key messages are the elders of today trying to pass along to current youth? So is there something new that's changed in past generations? Is there a key message that we're trying to educate new generations on? And then on population data management, has your community practiced any specific data collection techniques? So a lot of your communities might have already been doing some kind of data collection or land planning, and maybe this conversation's already come up. Or maybe it's just a general practice that's already been in use for several years or generations. So techniques on populations and kill counts from year to year. How is that information actually tracked? So I think it might be worth just putting it in there, but there's no need to be, I think, skeptical about sharing information. I think the idea was purely just to open the floor for a discussion with somebody new and have that dialogue, just like I've had conversations with my community members, and I've felt like it's been really important sharing time to learn from them. So by having a dialogue with two or three new people, you might realize that there's other people that are having some of the same or very different concerns that you might be having on this topic.
So the topic we had, and I'm defaulted to the speaker here, with support from my team. So really, the first thought that came up was to talk about what's happening with some of the intertreaty harvesting, and at least one community has identified that for at least Moose concerns, that they're looking at stopping the letter, or have stopped the approval of intertreaty harvesting from the community's support because of the decline of the Moose population. And this actually comes down to another piece about relating to the intertreaty harvest letters is. Some communities are looking to try and track the harvest to understand what harvest is being taken from people coming into their traditional territory and what exactly they're harvesting or in some cases limiting what they can harvest. So in one example, a person received a letter from a community where they wanted to harvest, and it controlled or stipulated what exactly that person could harvest within that traditional area. So a couple of pieces around the intertreaty harvesting. Certainly some concerns raised with sharing some of the data with government agencies and outside of the community. With the light that there's some pros when communities want to move towards a co-management framework with Ontario. Specifically, we're talking about MNRF and the Moose Project in this case. And there's some work going on with some communities, although slow, as far as some better understanding of Moose and working together. There was a lot of discussion about not a formal tracking system, with the exception of one community, which actually did surveys with, I think it was 80 members, harvesters within their community, and got specific details. But generally, a lot of the information collected from community members is kind of word of mouth and talking to some of the elders to understand what the current population is and what the kind of trends are with population and manage data that way. So to understand if populations are getting stressed or if they're improving, so the communication is more a verbal communication and not officially documented. We did talk a little bit about concerns raised with the current allocation system that MNRF has imposed with moose harvest in some areas. And also the recognition that coming out of that land users are the traditional users on the land base are seeing different trends from what MNR is talking about. So in this particular case, MNR's issued a lot of tags, which is adult validation tags for regulated hunters, and which has impacts on the traditional users. And not necessarily the information that the government is presenting is the same information that the traditional and the people and the elders are seeing on the land base. We talked a little bit about trap line and how we can better or how communities can better access trap lines and through the trap line allocation process. And does it have to be on an individual basis, or is there some way to share information between the communities and have collect some information within the communities to help support the community when trap lines become available? We did talk about whether it was important or not to document, and there were some pros and cons around whether we need to document, but it was raised that if we do document harvest within the communities at the community level, that it can help support harvest information and also land use planning. So if you're looking at protecting areas, so if a community gets a letter from a forest company saying we're going to spray this area, if the people within the band office or whoever's reviewing those applications doesn't understand or have the information from the actual land user at that area, they don't have that kind of information recorded, it may not get collected and may not get passed on when that consultation piece comes up. So unless there's communication and understanding on the land base of what people's needs are, where they're harvesting, what activities they're doing where, it's hard for somebody that may be in a consultation role within a community to understand and help support them and their activities. I think there's just a couple things on this page. Once again, there may be reluctance. We identified that in our discussion that there may be reluctance within the community, amongst members, to share even with the community for fear of people knowing exactly what they're doing or where they're at and wanting to protect their own area and not share that information. And just the kind of the counterpart to that is we just need to be clear, if we're looking to collect data from people, exactly what that information is going to be used for and how that helps support them and their activities. So that was the discussion. I'll throw it over to the group here to see if I miscaptured anything here, if there's some other points that you'd like to raise.
Okay, so we had number three, modern elder and youth teachings. We would have been nice to have an elder to help us, but we wrote down. So taking care of the land is one of the teachings that we were aware of. Respect, I believe this refers to respecting the animals and the fish and the land and the water, everything you're harvesting. Only take what is needed and share with the community. Share with people who aren't able to hunt. Pass on knowledge to the youth. And spend more time outdoors. And we also threw in, I'm not sure what traditional teachers is referring to. Was that point? You wrote it down. So.
Like just teaching traditional practices to the youth.
Right. All right. So maybe it's connected to this point. We thought that there's opportunities for government, provincial or federal, to support programs that bring youth to the land, on the land, to help facilitate that teaching. I want to name a few agencies here. So I think the M&R would be a good candidate to support those initiatives. If there's any M&R people here. Oh, there is. Okay, so some of the challenges we found, or we came up with, are some youth can be disconnected. There's a lot of outside influences like TV, internet. There's a lot of distractions that could hold youth back from getting out on the land as much as perhaps they used to. Technology advances, so the nature of being out on land has changed or is changing. So rifles getting more high-powered, ATVs, changes from traditional approaches. And again, we threw in funding from government again here. We just thought it was worth repeating. So, you know, funding from M&R perhaps. And other issues affect this, so not quite sure. I think that was related to we're talking about how some of these programs, if they're supported, it could help with addiction and help healing. So yeah, that was it. That's all we had. Any questions or anything? Anything to add from the group?
Any elders?
Is there any elders here that could?
I'd like to suggest that we hear from Group 1 on traditional harvesting practices, because I think you'll see a lot of links, which is a good thing to know that from traditional to modern, we've kept a lot of our practices.
Yes.
Thank you. I'm really glad that you guys thought about challenges, because it didn't really dawn on me when I put the slide together, but obviously there's going to be challenges in modern day today when trying to teach modern day youth. We know that there's been so many changes, so I'm glad that you added that whole topic on challenges. I'm willing to hold that just so the video can capture you. Thank you.
Okay, our question was number 2, what has changed in the last few generations from the traditional spring fall hunt practices? First one, we came up with population is down. A lot of our different animal species have grown less. Less populated, or even our people living in the north are migrating to the south, to the urban centers and whatnot. So we'll also have to deal with climate change. A lot of our, for example, polar bears are coming more south. A lot of the migration have moved inland rather than staying on the coast of whatever bay, James Bay, Hudson Bay. Migration route has changed, maybe because of the different hydro lines or power lines that are going, they might be following that rather than the main, their natural migration route, like the James Bay, the rivers and the lakes, whatever. Also, what has changed, the cost of trying to take your family into hunt into the traditional grounds, you have to take a chopper or a float plane, so the cost of that, just taking them in, not only the cost of travel, but also the cost of your ammunition, your grub, and all that kind of stuff, is this cost of living has gone way up, so less families are taking their traditional hunts. Role changes, there's more women into hunting. They can bag a moose like any other guy. But also, not only that, the family dynamics, a lot of men have left the responsibility, so you find a lot of single-parent families and women fending for themselves to ensure that their children get traditional foods, geese or moose. My sister-in-law actually liked a nice bull moose there over the weekend, so, you know, so just to have that traditional food, you know. Winter roads, a lot of them, our seasons have grown shorter, our winters have just went by so fast, we don't have no winter roads. So modern technology, we got young people hunting with drones, they don't leave their house yet till they spot the moose and then they hit out the road and whatnot. And modern technology, plus the different types of guns, you got automatic guns where they can just take down the whole flock and not leave one flying. So, you know, killing off the whole group that is migrating. Also on hunting competitions, there's pros and cons to that. You can either use it to keep your hunting festivities alive in your community, or once again, the other spectrum is that they can overkill the animal and try to win a grand prize, could be a 4x4 truck or whatever it is. So, and just forget about the factor of you have to leave some animals so that they can repopulate. So that's out there too. Games, different types of preparing your game. A lot of our traditional ways of preparing, like geese, for instance, we can can them, smoke them, half smoke them, and prepare them for a long-term keep. And that practice is out there. Hardly people are practicing that. So the traditional way is sort of not passed on, I guess. And also some animals are not harvested, like ducks, beavers, when some of the traditional foods our elders like to eat. A lot of our young people are not harvesting those. So it's more like a recreation purpose now, as survival versus recreation. So we're more in recreation now, I guess, in this day and age, I guess. In some areas, northern communities, it's still a survival because of the cost of living. Northern stores, prices are skyrocketed. Like a case of a bottle, case of water would probably be $100 in some areas. So that's so you have something that's very evident to survival and versus recreation. We also got less people harvesting into fur-bearing animals because they're not into trapping and whatnot, so that's part of a traditional hunt that's practically not practiced hardly anymore because they probably don't know how to even do their moose hide anymore. Very minimal people know that knowledge, how to tan your moose into hide. And then going from there, like your moccasins and your mitts and whatnot. And there's also a cost that's in part of that. And then when you don't have this, it possibly but the knowledge is not passed on. Maybe a lot of elders have took the knowledge with them. But back home in Moose Factory, you find that people are videotaping the process of how to kill and to tan and smoke and how to use your beads and beadwork and all that. Another way to keep your culture alive is back in Quebec, in the Quebec Crees, they have the curriculum implemented into traditional practices. They have a camp just in the boundaries of the community. Right up to grade 8, they go into these shabastons, and they learn how to make skin your moose, beaver, lynx, whatever else, how to prepare it into food, how to use your hides, and how to sew, and how to make snowshoes, and how to make medicine out of your animals. And so that's one way to keep this practice alive.
We had number one describe the traditional teachings on sustainable harvesting. We wrote, if you kill it, you eat it, no waste of anything. Share with the elders and tobacco offerings for the kill. Kills are shared equally. Learn by watching. This is for the young. It was a question asked how the young are taught. So they learn by watching how their elder is doing when he hunts, then practice. And the ducks, the older children, the children are allowed to go hunting when they're 10, when they're in the springtime. But they go with an elder too. And no killing of cows with calves. Traditional days are on the land for different age groups.
You want to elaborate on that one a little bit? You were explaining that. Maybe just talk about
okay. Like we have for kids in October, we allow them, they're allowed to go partridge hunting. One day from age, they go by age groups, and the girls go out, they go with the boys to under 10. They're only allowed to use slingshots, no weapons of any sort. So that's how they learn how to, if they're ever stranded out in the field. And also, we don't kill partridges in the spring or during the summer, only in the fall. That's to harvest them. So they get more partridges in the fall, I guess.
There's another page here.
Well, we talked about trap lines too. Before trap lines, there were less sharing, land sharing issues, because everybody could trap where they could trap with their friends and neighbors. Then along came those trap lines, and that's where the land sharing issues became. So misunderstanding of commercial trap lines and boundaries versus family trap lines. I guess that's it.
And that's it. If you want to talk a little bit about that though, I think people might be familiar with that, but there is a lot of misunderstanding between
commercial trapping
and harvesting for sustainability, right? Family yeah. trap lines.
Well, before trap lines were given to us, as my dad used to say, we used to trap any place we wanted to. And we used to go and trap with people from Bearskin, Big Trout, and their trap lines. Then those trap lines were issued, I don't know when. That's when it became a problem. We had poachers, as you call them, came into our trap lines. They belonged to another trap line.
Poachers.
So that's where the... It's still going on today. Yes, there are some people that are still hanging on to their trap lines.
Thank you. Anyone from Group 1 want to add to any of those comments, as you just read through a couple of them, but... Good?
I was just going to say with the commercial trap lines, well, they were put in place by MNR for selling of pelt, and that's why the trap and biodiversity were put in place, but it was with the traditional way of thinking, I guess it was more for family and groups, so... And nowadays you hear, like, say, in my community, you hear somebody or even comments on Facebook, so-and-so, I heard, or they'll hear of other community band members going into their trap line and saying, I don't want people coming to my trap line to hunt or to fish, like the most extraction of fish from.
Yeah, we hear a lot, right? And almost everybody at their planning tables or even through consultation, there seems to be a lot of confusion and disgruntled trappers out there on rights to trap lines and what trap line associations actually mean and the rights of trappers versus harvesters. And we will tomorrow, actually, we have some different staff, or I don't know, is it going to be Andy as well? Andy's actually going to be talking about trap line administration tomorrow at some time too and could answer some of those questions. But yeah, we do know that there's some wide misunderstandings. So we're going to continue, but this is our fifth question, and we didn't have time for a fifth table, but under it's a consideration. So current and future habitat sustainability, when we're considering this, what should be considered or practiced for future sustainable populations in harvesting? And I think we captured a lot of that, but if there's any key comment that anybody in the room really... Like if you learned something new today or captured a comment from somebody that you would take home, is there a message out here that we shared today that is kind of new knowledge to anybody in the room? I would just be really happy to hear. So anyway, do we have any key ideas on considerations?
I think it's really interesting that they're all kind of tied in together. Those, you know, the first four questions we had are all, you know, a lot of the same ideas, the same answers, like, flow into one another. So this is kind of,
So this would kind of be, you know, the considerations of it is it's, they're all connected, right, in some way.
Another one being Natalie touched on at the work was the moose, how it's kind of, during traditional hunting, it's too much overkill of calves and cows. And it's like maybe they should have enforce a rule where you can't kill cows like actually enforced the.
Yeah, they touched on it in modern practices. We saw that
goes
there's
back to
survival versus recreation, and we see a lot more recreational hunting and competitive hunting for the prizes. You know, you win a truck for whoever brings in the most kills, or we have these hunting competitions now. So we see that that starts to take away from traditional practices when it starts being a competition. But at the same point, it might be the little bit of motivation to get the new generations out on the land, trying the traditional practices and educating and passing on that knowledge. So it's a fine balance, but we have seen communities talking about how sport and recreation hunting in the north has increased the kill counts and has caused a change in habitat numbers, and which is really sustainability of the population. So it is a table topic in the north for sure, in the communities that I work with.
Oh, for sure. I would agree, but also meeting group there that they don't do the traditional hunt, you know, or the hunting derby. So that was kind of really neat to hear about as well. So, and then of course some of our group does, right? Same thing with us. We're kind of down the middle too. So, yep.
Okay.
Oh,
just one more. I think it's a challenge to try and talk about this because I think the remote part of Ontario is much different than the south. And our, not to say this is right or wrong, but there's a lot of communities that think that this is not our issue. First Nation people make up about 4% of the population of Canada. How is it our issue that moose over-harvest them? Like the clan moose problem is our issue. And we heard in our group community where there's 2,300 tags given out in their traditional area, yet their community of, I don't know how many people, 600, 800 people. I mean, even if we over-proportionately harvest animals or hunt more than our non-native people, we're still a small fraction of the stresses that are on the animals we hunt. And I know some bands in Ontario take that approach where, how is this our issue? Well, and we have treaty rights, and a rights holder is a lot different than a hunter who buys a license. Hunting's a privilege, it's not a right. Well, that's not, we have hunting rights, that's a lot different. So how is it our issue that if there's enough moose to feed our communities, if the M&R or the province wants to have a recreational moose hunt or a tourism industry, then that's their issue. How is it ours now? I'm not saying that's the right way, I'm just saying a lot of community members.
It's just recognizing that there's different issues from the far north to central Ontario to the more populated areas. There's definitely very different issues in different regions of the province, for sure. Yeah.
I just want to make a comment too. I think not only the traditional practices, but it's a big big dent in our culture. This is who we are, you know, this is what we survived on, is our livelihood depended on hunting, like we're hunter and gatherers people, right?
Yeah.
So take that out of the picture. Who are we as a culture of people, like First Nation people, which people?
Huge, you know, impacts on cultural identity.
For sure.
Yeah. Very good comments. We're going to end it there. I love the topic. I'd love to talk more about it with anybody, but we're going to give Andy the time that we promised him, and he's done some really good work in putting some slides together to tell us what the ministry is doing on this topic. So
good afternoon. So I'm Andy Locke. I'm with the Ministry of Natural Resources and Forestry. I'm going to start by saying this is not my presentation. I'm not a biologist. I'm a practitioner. Kind of my background is I've worked as almost 25 years in the Northwest. Most of my career has been in Sioux Lookout. I worked out of Sioux Lookout. Most of my working career has been, I'm a conservation officer for almost 20 years. I've done a lot of management work, and currently I'm working with our regional office, and my current job title is Regional Aboriginal Advisor. So I help provide some advice to the government on engaging and consulting and try to do some networking. And so today I'm going to give you a little bit of an overview on how Ontario MNRF, what some of the considerations are that we look at when we're looking at managing moose and some of the things that we take into account. So I'm not going to get into a whole lot of specific detail. I'm not a biologist, and that would take a full day. For those that happened to attend the moose, any of the moose project workshops, we got into a lot more detail. And if there's people that are interested in the future, we can provide you some more specific detail. But really, we just have a few minutes to talk about some high-level stuff, so I just want to give you a bit of an overview. So we're just going to talk a little bit about what the factors are that, that affect moose population. Just have a very brief snapshot on carrying capacity and habitat, effects of climate change, parasites and diseases, predation, harvest, and then talk a little bit of, at the end, if we have time, just about how Ontario or MNRF, what some of the objectives that we use when we're setting population. So you may have seen similar slides to this, but this really just shows, and we're specifically talking about moose, but this does get applied to other species as well. But just when we're talking about moose, these are some of the different factors that we take into account and consideration as we're setting moose population objectives and talking about how, from a recreational harvest, license-regulated harvest perspective, we set quotas and limits. So we've got climate, hunting, competitors, predators, parasites, accidents, habitat. I think during our working group, there was a comment about, there's more moose killed on the highway than are killed within the community. So that's a factor to take into consideration. I was talking with some individuals that we were doing a wildlife policies piece a couple weeks ago, and they were saying there's more moose killed by trains than are harvested within a community. So there's lots of factors that affect moose population outside of anybody's control. So this really is just a bit of a snapshot to kind of look at where Ontario is kind of identified the highest density populations. May not be numbers, but just densities, and is based on a number of factors, including forest type, precipitation, weather, temperatures, with the darker colors being the more densely populated moose areas. Now, there's been some change since this. You can see it's this little spot in the west. For those that come potentially from the Lake of the Woods area, you're going to know that the population in the last few years has really declined in that area. So that this lighter area is growing more than getting a little bit lighter than it is darker in that area. But this is just a snapshot. And like I said, if you've got some specific information that you like for your area, that we can get you that later. Now you see the 11th baseline. That's kind of the cutoff for moose population as far as a lot of the more specific data we collect, because a lot of our moose management is tied in with forest management. And that's the biggest tool that we have when we're managing habitat for moose is through our forest management planning and the processes that we use in the approval and regulation of harvesting forests. So there is more information above the 11th baseline in the far north. It's not captured within these slides that were put together for another presentation. So once again, this just talks about our biggest habitat manipulation in Ontario for moose, and where we control habitat for moose is through the forest management planning process. So that's the tool that we've got some guidelines, regulations in that forest management companies have to follow in order to achieve wildlife management targets and goals. So whether that be primarily in this area is moose targets, but there's also caribou targets depending on what the featured species are. So we're getting up into the kind of the Lake St. Joe area and across into north of Lake Nipigon, gets more focused into caribou management and supporting caribou. The habitat requirements for caribou and moose are different, so there's some different management objectives for that. So it depends on what the key species is, but that's the greatest tool that we have, or the most effective tool we have currently for trying to manage the forest for moose habitat. So climate change is really having some significant impacts on all species, and in particular moose. We're seeing in this part of Ontario, northwestern Ontario, seeing a lot of impacts of the changes in climate over the last few years. And you can see this is just a couple graphs, and really can't see what it says, but this talks about the temperatures, and we can see that in the last number of years we've had a lot of winters where the average temperatures are considerably above normal, which is impacting moose, and also precipitation levels are quite a bit lower, so that's affecting your snow levels. The reason that these are important, there's a couple of different things. It's predators and the impacts on predators. So if you've got not a lot of snow on the ground, can increase the movability and the movement of wolves and other predators to gain access to moose and harvest more moose that way from the predator standpoint. Plus also with the warmer weather, there's a number of different factors that influence moose population when we're seeing the warmer temperatures. In fall time, it can affect the rut. So kind of throw off the schedules between the bulls and the cows on when the rutting period is. So the success rate or the recruitment, as we talk about in the kind of the science side, how many calves can we bring into the system or will be coming into the system is directly proportional to how successful the rut is. So if we get into warmer temperatures, it throws off those cycles between the cows and the bulls and can lead to lower calf reproduction and less calves coming into the system. So that's, you're talking about the harvest of cows and calves, that even becomes more important if we're not getting the calves in the system. It can also affect parasites like winter tick, some other diseases. We get into to freezing rain events more, so we're getting more freezing rain because we're not getting the cooler temperatures, which affects the core temperature. And if animals are suffering from high infestation of winter ticks, which kills the hair follicles and the moose generally lose a lot of their protective outside layer, they start getting into freezing rain events. That affects their survivability as well and can impact long term, especially as the winter gets into the later part of the winter and food is harder to get. They've had a long winter. It can increase mortality of moose. So that's written out basically just some of the points I just captured as far as some of the impacts of climate change. So increase of freezing rain, increase warmer temperatures, the variation of the rut. So diseases and parasites, for moose hunters, and a lot of you will be familiar with a lot of the diseases and parasites. Brainworm is one that's, this is a result of some of the increases in brainworm we're seeing because of climate change as well. The brainworm is a parasite that functions well and is transferred in primary host of white-tailed deer. So a white-tailed deer can have brainworm and it shows no impacts or effects of the parasite within the deer. The brainworm gets transferred to moose, and as the temperature is increasing, we're seeing the white-tailed deer moving forward, partly because they're not getting as much predator pressure. They're having an easier winter. The population of deer are increasing and moving further north. We're seeing the transfer of the brainworm from white-tailed deer onto the impacting the moose. When the brainworm impacts the moose, without getting into a lot of the life cycle, the food, the moose will then eat something that's infected with the parasite. The worm actually goes into the bottom of the brainstem, and basically it does some neurological effects to the moose, and the moose can't control itself. It doesn't know when to eat. It becomes less afraid of predators. And in the worst case scenarios, I don't know if people have seen it on videos, but there's videos of actually moose just going in circles, because it can't function. Usually it's to the left. They'll just keep walking around and around in circles because they don't understand what's going on, what the impacts are, until they finally starve or get taken off by a wolf or some other predator. I've had the case three times now where we've had moose that are just going around in circles and we've dispatched them to put them out of their misery. It's not a fun thing to see, but it's part of life and part of reality that we deal with. Liver flukes, they're not transferable or really have impacts on the moose. They're not transferable to humans, but they do. When you get a moose that's stressed from other factors, when you get liver flukes or some of these other winter ticks or get it down into some of the tumors, when you get multiple factors that are affecting or stressing moose, we'll see increased predation and death of moose. So all these combined and with the impacts of climate change, we're seeing more and more of these kind of compressed and impacting populations of moose.
I know it might be hard to answer, but all of those, like, what's the sort of mortality out of 1,000 moose? Like, how much does a brainworm actually take?
I'd have to get those specific numbers for you.
But you say it's increasing with warmer weather. Like, how much? Is it alarming, or is it?
Well, it's just, it's the increase of the deer population moving north and impacting. And I don't have those numbers, but I can probably track down some numbers for you, but I don't have those numbers. But I think on the winter tick, I'm trying to remember what it was, somewhere around, I won't get into it.
Okay. Yeah.
Somebody in there has them. Yeah, and we can get that information. I'll leave some business cards. You can grab some business cards after. So predation is something that's, to the most part, not very well understood by MNRF. There may be people within the room here, within your communities, that have a better understanding of predation. So we at the MNRF took an initiative over the last couple of years to try and capture some data and some information on predation of moose, particularly by wolves. So I'm just going to talk a little bit about this one spot around Nakina here. I don't have all the information for all the spots with me today, but just to give you a sense. So this was mostly focused on wolf and the impact of wolf on moose in that area around Nakina. So it was collecting scat, wolf scat, and analyzing the wolf scat to see what they're harvesting, what they're eating. So in the area of Nakina, you can see there was about moose was the highest content within the scat. So within the Nakina area, there's the predation level of moose by wolves is fairly high. Where in some of the other areas, more to the east, where we didn't see as many wolf encounters, that number changed, and it really seems to have impacts on the density. When we talked about density of the wolves and density of the moose, the more dense, higher density areas for moose populations, we're seeing that the wolves are picking up on the moose and targeting the moose more often. One of the things that they did find, and through some of the DNA testing and the site investigation on the wolf predation, is and it may be, it's pretty easy to understand that the calves and the yearlings, and then when you get up into the older, kind of more mature animals, the 12, 13, and for moose, on from the data that we have, the most productive for the top end of the productivity is around 12, 13 years, and then although they can last till about 20 or 20, I think there was one that was recorded at 22, analyzed at 22 years of age for a moose. Really, the numbers start declining after 13. 13 years of age, the population starts declining off as far as number of mature animals. So kind of the peak for maturity and survivability is 12, and then it starts declining. So that's why this is understandable, the calves here, and then 11, 12, 13 is when they become very vulnerable again to wolves and predation. And then as the population is declining, we're seeing just those reflective numbers declining throughout the rest of the age structure. There was also through some of the work in Nakina looking at predation of bears. And as you can see, really not a lot of bears taken from, or moose taken by bear in relation. The biggest predator seems to be wolves, at least in the Nakina area. But the bears are opportunistic, and where they have the opportunity are, they're gonna take, once again, it's the calves and the yearlings that are probably most vulnerable, and then followed by kind of the sick and elderly that in the population that the bears are gonna target. But there is some harvest by bears, but not nearly what we were seeing with the wolf. So harvest, we're running out of time here, but I just wanted to give you a snapshot. So this is regulated harvest. So this is what we're talking about MNR issues, licenses to non-rights bearing people that want the privilege to go out and hunt. So they get licenses. There's approximately 107,000 licensed hunters that hunt for moose across the province in different areas. Moose hunters need to apply for certain tags. So moose license is valid for a calf license. So if I go in and buy a license, I'm automatically allowed to harvest a calf, and then I have to apply for either a bull or a cow in a certain wildlife management unit. As we talked about in our group, there's some management units that have really high tag allocations for one sex or the other, which is Ontario's way of trying to manage the population through balancing the male and female ratio. So really, it's applying for these tags. If you're successful, then you're allowed to hunt a large animal. If not, then you hunt as a group and take what you can get, what you're licensed for. So this, as I mentioned, we try to balance the bull and the cow ratio. So we had a pretty good ratio for a while, and overall the trend has been declining populations across the province. And that's why we've really taken a step back over the last few years and saying our current system isn't working right. We need to look at how to improve the system. So I think with that, because we're just about out of time, we want to leave a little bit of question.
There's 10 minutes, so that's what I was trying to tell you.
Okay.
So
I just have two more slides, and these are the considerations that M&R looks at. So when we're setting population objectives, there's the main ecological population range. So we're looking at range management. We're looking at what the suitable habitat is within the range. So whether it's at an ecological zone or what we call a wildlife management zone, what's the available habitat within that zone, and what can that habitat sustain for a population? What are the other cervids or the other primarily deer, caribou species in that area? What's the balance between those species and moose in what the overall objective is? Do we want to increase caribou? Do we want to decrease white-tailed deer in a certain area, or do we want to keep the balance the same? And just the overall interactions as far as what do we know about predators, harvest, and other factors that affect moose population. And then when we get into actually setting the targets, it gets more into the social economic. So what are the interests? So this is can be anybody's interests, whether it's First Nations, other Indigenous groups, the recreational hunters, the tourists, the NGOs, so the non-government environmental groups. What are all the interests and concerns that may be factored within the area? Traditional activities. Supporting spiritual and cultural benefits, areas of accessibility. So roads have a huge impact on success of hunt. So provides more opportunities for different types of equipment, more access, and therefore generally it means increases success rates within those areas. So as we see more roads, we're seeing a higher success rate of harvest for groups. So those are all factors that are really factored in, considered as Ontario tries to set limits and regulate the regulated hunters and licensed hunters within the province. So really that's a very quick overview on how M&R manages moose within the province. And I just want to say thanks for having me here, and we certainly can provide some further information. I can leave some business cards with you and come and chat.
Back to the slide that had the table of before and now. It had a lot of good information there, but you're talking about managing populations, and a lot of that is done through the hunting licenses too, right? Like there was a lot of information. I know in the extensive presentation on this on how they justify and determine how many licenses to give out every year and whether they're for bulls, calves, cows. So a lot of the data collected is going towards determining the provincial hunting allowances, right?
Yep. So one of the things that we talked about, at least the breakout group I was in, was data. And one of the pieces of data, we track all the numbers of licenses that are issued and who's getting what for what certain wildlife management unit or zone. We don't have a mandatory reporting system where I, as a hunter, a regulated hunter, have to put in saying I harvested, I didn't harvest. We do have a voluntary piece. And it comes back to the comment that was made about some people don't trust the information. So even if we did make it mandatory, we may not get any better information than what we get through a voluntary process. So that's one of the rationale for going to the voluntary piece. And I'm not a statistician, but we have statisticians that work with us that say this is how much information you need to get back to be reasonably, you got a bit of a variation, but reasonably confident that the information that somebody's providing you on a voluntary basis is consistent with what the is actually happening on the ground. So that's something that can be used, and we can share with you about how that could be used if you want to try and collect some information on a voluntary basis and try to help format that. This information, if we get X percent of the population that's doing this activity provides us some information, we can, from a statistics point of view, say this is pretty close to what is actually happening. It may not be accurate because some people are still going to lie. Some people think they're going to put something on a piece of paper because they want to achieve a goal or something else at the end, and they think this is going to help. So there's always going to be those kind of problems. We're never going to get 100% without going back to the days when you had to go to a station and get somebody to check off and actually see the animal and take something. We're not going to go back to that. But so that's how we collect some of this information. So when it talks about success rate and how many animals are harvested, that's extrapolated from this information that we collect. And like I said, from I'm not a statistician, but the people that do work with numbers are saying this is as accurate as we're going to get.
My community's near Sault Ste. Marie.
Yep.
So there's sort of a deer, moose, and it seemed, a lot of this stuff I'm writing down because it's new to me, that the predation and stuff and those things that affect deer. It seemed like there's sort of a moose, deer, teeter-totter. When there's lots of deer, it seems like we see less moose and vice versa. The deer are managed so intensively, and a lot of people in my community think, I don't even think deer are supposed to be up this far north. If it was for agriculture and forestry, I can't even believe that there'd be that much deer here now. But yet, it's very hard to get a doe tag around Sault Ste. Marie. Now that I moved to Thunder Bay, they see deer north of Sioux Lookout? I mean, holy cow, they wouldn't even be that far if it wasn't for us yet. It's hard to get a doe tag around here. I mean, is MNR considered, if you want to shoot a deer, go ahead and shoot as many deer as you want? I mean,
In recent years, through the regulated hunt, there has been what's been introduced as additional deer tags. So there's lots of wildlife management units where you can get up to 5 deer licenses.
Yeah. In the Sault Ste. Area.
Yeah. So that is to try and reduce the deer population to help support the moose population.
It's management, species management, really.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, there is that dichotomy between moose and white-tailed deer.
Any other questions?
Yes?
I'm not sure if you'll be able to answer this, but for calf harvest, so if you don't get a cow or a bull, you basically get a consolation prize of a calf.
Yes.
Which doesn't make sense to me. Like, so they're already very highly targeted by prey, and now, like, if you don't get a tag, you automatically can go out and shoot one. And if there's so many hunters, like, I just don't understand how that's a sustainable practice.
I couldn't figure that out either, but it was
explained to me. So the basic rationale, without getting into a whole lot of science and detail, is calves are not sought after generally by hunters. It provides an opportunity for me to go out hunting that the likelihood of harvest and the success rate on calves are very low. So provides from... Can I turn this off? provides the government an income on selling licenses. So I buy a license as a hunter, and I pay my fee to be able to hunt, and I get a calf tag. Then I have to apply for a bull tag. This year, the group that I hunt with did not get an adult tag, so we're not going to hunt. So I paid my money. They've got the money. I'm not going to go hunt a calf because I really don't believe in hunting calves, and there's lots of people in the regulated community, like you're hearing here, that don't want to harvest a calf. So it's an opportunity that hunters have, and lots of hunters will choose not to take that opportunity, and yet it generates some revenue. And with the information that the harvest of a calf is a low probability, and the number of calves harvested are low. So that's the rationale there.
When you're determining, when the MNR is determining the number of tags to put out for a certain management unit, consider First Nation traditional territory, what role or say or involvement does that community have?
At this point,
in terms of issuing the licenses and generating revenue and stuff like
that. At this point in time, there's no relationship there. There's no direct relationship between communities and harvest within the management units. We've had a lot of discussion about that within my group about how we can do that. But part of the challenge is when we look at the zones, so what we manage at, which we're trying to manage at a higher level zone, so it can be quite a large and it can encompass, in some areas, a dozen First Nation communities. So how does M&R, this might be a discussion for later because we're running out of time here, how can M&R involve communities in that kind of discussion? At what scale is going to work? If we were to look at like a Treaty 3 level, because I'm from the Sulakot area, kind of get my head around that, there's two, three, four management, wildlife management units within Treaty 3, and how many communities within each, like how do we manage that and collect that information and share back and forth about kind of what a target would be for that. So is there a pilot or something that we can look at one management unit with some communities and talk about what population estimates were? And so that's some of the discussions that we had last year at the Moose Workshop is how can we talk about getting information and sharing information about population objectives when we're dealing with so many, when we're dealing with a higher scale of land base and a number of communities within that.
And getting the communities to support the initiative as well.
Yeah.
Stephen, you had a question?
How did they determine to put some of the tags out a year?
So I don't...
And why?
Mm-hmm. Well, it's based on a percentage. So based on last year's harvest, looking at the population, how many animals we think are within that population, there's an allowable, what they call an allowable harvest. So if there's a population of 100,000, maybe we can, there's 10,000 animals that can be harvested. And then within that, there's a breakdown about within 10,000 animals, there might be 5% bulls and 10% cows or something like that. And it's based on wildlife management unit and the success rate. But
how do you guys determine that?
Determine
data statistics, like they gather data and yeah. They...
I know, but in the past, so the nature takes care of itself. And there was no concern in regard to tanks 10 years ago. Why all of a sudden?
Well, because there's so much pressure, especially in the south. Like I know.
Pressure from the government?
No, pressure from hunters. Pressure from hunters to have access to the area.
Yeah, the nature has been taking care of itself for the last 100 years. Why it started worrying about what the production.
But on that comment, you say nature's been taking care of itself, but we've also seen, based on the data collected, you see change in populations, right?
So it's -2 last weekend.
So you let nature take care of itself and there's no hunting at all, populations are going to go up.
Yeah.
And you allow any hunting you want, populations are going to decline too fast, so their job is to find what the proper balance is, right? Allowing the hunting and not allowing it, so that's left to task for that department, right?
Yeah, like in Lake of the Woods area, there's very little moose population left. So, what should be done? Like from a regulated standpoint, we've shut down the adult harvest for a lot of Lake of the Woods area.
Well, there's a lot of accidents, moose accidents on the highway. But see,
yeah,
there's more accidents now than there were 5 years ago.
Yep.
I'm going to cut this off and just thank Andy. Andy's going to be around for the next day, and he's presenting again tomorrow on trap lines, so if you got more questions for him, just find him.
Sure.
But on behalf of our committee, thank you for coming today. We appreciate your presentation, so please take that.
Thank you very much.